Alex, for insisting. Standard Surgeon General's warning. This is true in every class. Don't believe anything you hear. On the other hand, consider the sources. Shouldn't believe anything a professor says, but they've been around, so you should check it out thoroughly. Okay, the last one is critical because the subject of this whole semester is large. I've got less than 50 minutes to give you a few ways of thinking about it. Not all of them, not all of the ways, but the big deal here is pretty much everything that you've been told about computing is wrong. Particularly, got a question for my brain barf, which I declined to answer because it was too long and complicated about what do I think about the CS curriculum here, especially in the undergraduate, but it stinks. It's that simple. Because it's completely missing the point about what real computing is about, which has nothing to do with putting one line of code after another line of code. It has to do with designing systems. And so if you're gonna be anything other than a grunt, a simple bricklayer, now of course you can make money laying bricks. But if you want anything more, you have to start poking your nose into the much more non-linear complexities of design. Design is difficult in part because our brains are not well set up for it. We tend to tinker. We tend to be protected when we're children. So our tinkering is usually constrained enough so that most of the things we do won't kill us. And this leads to really bad habits, because we tend to tinker for the rest of our lives. So this is an excellent, good old book by Griot from 1960 or so. And here's a classic. You may recognize the name Christopher Alexander. He's an architect who inspired some of the pattern language stuff. Excuse me. Take those out of your ears. Thank you. But this is Alexander's first book. It's actually his PhD thesis. Extremely well written. Alexander was a German who came to the United States to study architecture. This is a thesis he did at Harvard. And he later repudiated it because he thought it was too mechanistic. But in fact, the front part of it and the example that he has are still among the very best things ever written about design. This book has been continuously in press since about 1964. It's worthwhile getting. And the weak parts that are weak by today's standards, or even those standards, doesn't matter. Because the overall view, what he thinks about, how he thinks about what you're trying to do in your design, is larger than architecture. In fact, he winds up designing a village in India as his example for the thesis. It has about 700 or 800 constraints of various kinds, including religious ones. So it's worthwhile reading this book just to get to this example. And here's a book that nobody has written, somebody should, called The Softer the Subject, the Tougher You Must Be. And this is because the nice thing about physics is and chemistry and biology is that nature slams the door on you if you're reasonably careful. It will help bet your theories. And so it's hard to bullshit Mother Nature. But when you're in a bullshit field, like ours, a field that's primarily about design, primarily synthetic. We have the simplest of building blocks and we have the ultimate numbers of degrees of freedom. We're rife for fads. We're rife for every kind of design theory and bullshit and arguments. And because the computer, underlying computer material is quite strong, there's nothing like the forces of nature and weakness of the materials we build things with in the physical world to tear down terrible bridges that we make with computer. And so, probably the biggest difference between the average computer person today and the average researcher back in the 60s was that there were no computer science degrees as an undergraduate, and so almost everybody went into computing in grad school had gotten an undergraduate degree in something really difficult, something where you just had to kick ass, and something unforgiving, something had been worked on for a few centuries. And it just helped tremendously in trying to think about what the hell is computing. And for people who like simple heuristics, here's the one to be a designer. It's all about finding ways of being completely dissatisfied without getting so depressed you can't do anything. It's the number one thing. The biggest problem with computing today is that almost nobody is really dissatisfied with it. People are quite complacent to what is essentially a pile of crap. And the problem is that there's a half-life on good ideas, but not a half-life on bits. Bits are still around from 50 years ago, but most of the ideas of a good 50 years ago are terrible ideas now because of the scaling that's happened. And yet those ideas are still around. They're still the main ones that are being used. And because they are the main ones, and I'll go over this in a couple of different ways, they've set a kind of normal. They're what you expect. They're how you got into this class. So let's see, how many in this class, how many grad students? Okay, seniors? Juniors? Okay, first two? Freshman and sophomore? Okay, yeah, so you've already gotten through an enormous amount of bullshit and it hasn't made you throw up yet. This should make you profoundly worried, really worried, because it means you're able to cope with bad things. Whereas somebody with a way of being profoundly dissatisfied would be screaming or checked out. Think about that. Because human beings hardly did anything differently for several hundred thousand years. In fact, before there were human beings, hominids, when they made a stone axe, first stone axes that were made were hand axes, and they're shaped in such a way that when you chopped with them, they also chop back into your hand. And sometime later, a hand axe appeared that was blunt at the end that you held it, so it wouldn't chop back into your hand. Anybody like to guess the distance in time between those two designs?
No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, don't. You don't count. You've heard these talks. Anybody got an idea? Yes?
Let's say a couple hundred years.
300,000 years.
Goodness!
So 300,000 years, but let's use our imaginations. It's not possible that too many generations could go by before somebody, just by the law of numbers, even though these bands were only about 100 piece. But you know, after a few generations, somebody would say, Jesus, this thing is coming into my hand. And notice that the differently shaped one wasn't. And so I'm guessing that this blunt ended thing was reinvented many times. And just guess what must have happened to the person who invented it each and every time. They were violating the very theory of existence. Of the way of doing this, because a culture we have culture wars today, and a culture is about how a particular group decides to make their way through life. Attack a culture, you're attacking them. So in a design course, we have to talk about human beings, the very thing that you went into commuting to escape. Well known, the psychology of almost all people who go into computing, particularly, are people who are uneasy with other people. They love the little control, the little being the god of the little mechanical world. That's just what you say, you can control it. That's all of these wonderful things. And this accounts for the interesting fact that almost no computer people can design a good user interface to save their life, nor do they want to, because their world is learning whatever it takes to deal with an arbitrarily complicated system. And so from the standpoint of, I started in computing in 1961, so almost all code back then was written in machine code. But their higher level languages started appearing, and the first one of real interest was Fortran. An enormous amount of effort was put into by IBM to optimize the Fortran code, because they knew that they wouldn't have a chance on any other ground except efficiency to have Fortran make its way. So in fact, Fortran is extremely efficient, in many cases more efficient than handwritten code. But still, there was a backlash that lasted for about 15 years, because it was not manly to write in a higher level language. And this argument has repeated itself each time a new level of language comes along. So this means there's something desperately wrong about the psychology of what most programmers are about. Because in theory, you should be trying to make progress. But in fact, the psychology of program indicates that that is not anywhere near what most programmers are out after. Worthwhile thinking about what those might be. So if you look at Humans 101, of course they don't teach in the engineering college over here. It's kind of a blend of Hamlet, because our minds are basically theaters. It's a blend of limited resources. You've heard of 7 plus or minus 2, things you can hold in your mind, and actually been reduced. Because the first ones were just about how many numbers and letter sequences can you remember. But in the last 40 or 50 years since George Miller came up with this idea, it's been tested on a lot of different areas. And the truth is, we're terrible at multitasking. It's very difficult for us to hold multiple things in our heads at the time. We were tremendously resource limited. And the other thing is that most of our behavior would not be surprising to a primate or even most mammals, because an enormous amount of our behavior is actually older than humanity and older than our language mechanisms. So we're more theatrical than we think, we're have less resources than we think, and we're more different than we think. Why are we more different than we think? Anybody got an idea? Why aren't we aware of how bad off we are in the, say, the thinking part? Yes?
We can guess because we're humans and we can't really be aware of our behavior.
Let's hold that one. Yeah.
Egotism?
Pardon?
Egotism?
Well, it could be egotism. Could be, but let's hold on to that for a second. Okay, I passed out a reality kit to everybody, so let's open it.
Are we open?
Yes. Here's what it contains. Just tear it. So I suggest doing this, that you put it on a flat surface and lean over it, do just what it says, cover your eye. Focus on a plus with your left eye, cover your right eye, and move your head slowly in and back. The effect will happen. Don't move it side by side. Just move it in and back. About 9 inches away, something interesting will happen. Okay, how many see it or don't see it? Yeah. What happened? What happened to the dot?
It's hidden somewhere between your hands.
It went somewhere.
Went into a white part.
Yeah. And so what's interesting is, what is where the dot was? Yeah. So think about that for a second. Right? That cannot be, right? Cannot possibly be true. Yeah, so you see something like this, right? It's just kind of blurry text there. So here's what's going on. Unlike squids and octopi, we have very poorly designed eyes. In case you ever have an argument with a creationist, this is a good one. Now, it turns out squids and octopi had a different evolutionary pathway, and so nature wound up putting the blood vessels that supply the eye on the outside of the eye, perfectly reasonable place. For no particularly good reason, mammalian eyes, like ours, have the blood vessels actually coming through, and they actually lie on top of the light-sensitive cells. Is that the craziest thing you ever heard? Now, you don't see them because your brain is subtracting them out. But in fact, they're in the way. There they are. And where the blood vessels come in is where the optic nerve goes out, and there are no light-sensitive cells there. And here is a little area that when you look at something at normal reading distance is about 2 by 3 degrees, so it's about the size of the word, where almost all of your vision is concentrated. It's called fovea. So everything is completely nonlinear, and then there's this blank spot there. So when you move your head in, eventually, because you're focused on this thing, eventually this guy is going to hit where there aren't any light-sensitive cells, and just winks out. But now the fun begins, because immediately you see that what you actually think you're seeing is not what's on your retina. What's on your retina is these blood vessels and this blank spot. That's not what you see. What you see is something your brain puts together. Okay, here's another one. I didn't put coins in. I would have if the class had actually written its brain bars like it was supposed to, but that was pretty unprofessional not to be able to write a frigging half page of English. When did I put mine in? Tuesday morning, right?
Yep.
Come on, man, I'm busier than you are, believe me. Okay, 2 coins, 2 thumbs, 2 oranges, anything you know the size of. If you hold them up, so the one is twice as far away from the other, and if lenses in animals work the same way they do in when made out of glass, and geometry says the images on the back of the retina are going to be a given size and half that size, because that's what gets subtended. And in fact, you'll be glad to know that Descartes and Leonardo, in their respective centuries, both got ox eyes hit from a dead ox. The ox was already dead, and peeled the sclera off the back just to see whether biological lenses work the same way as glass ones that they started making do. So what you see on the back of the eye is that, but we've got this pachinko machine attached to the eye. In fact, if you know anything about biology, you know that the eye itself is actually part of the brain directly. That does a little bit of thinking. And this manifestation, which we call a process in computing, is partly has to do with our beliefs. So the image comes in, the light-sensitive cells see it, it goes to about a dozen different places in the brain, and then is compared with our beliefs. You think of this as the internet out here. Our consciousness is basically a waking dream. In other words, we're hallucinating all the time. I just proved it to you. I got you to not be able to see something that was actually there. We call that hallucination reality. Here's the answer to your question. The answer to your question is we actually don't live in a world in here that is like the world out here. We live in a world of our beliefs. And this is so strong that our beliefs know these two coins are the same size. And what our waking dream perceives is that the coins are actually 80, the further away one is 80% the size rather than half. Pretty cool, huh? You can try it anytime. Just have a couple of quarters on you. Should do this at least once a week. Along with the blind spot thing. Because unless you can accept this, you just can't, for instance, do science. The number one deal for actually being able to think in the modern world is to know that the world is not as it seems. So every time you do something that uses common sense, every time you have a fast reaction to something, you're actually going through this mechanism and you're just hit or miss as to whether all of these cached beliefs there that come from random encounters with the world have anything to do with the way the world looks at all. So this is the thing, to design, this is it. So what it means is every thought you have has to get put into a place that it can reverberate around before you start making conclusions from it. And if we have time, I'll show you a couple more goodies. So what this means is, and this is what we found out 400 years ago when science was invented for the first time, is we cannot learn to see until we admit we are blind. So our big problem was we thought we were seeing the world. And because we are driven by stories rather than experiments, we could explain things to each other by stories. This is Aristotle, for instance, wrote that he was married, but he wrote that women had fewer teeth than men. He never thought to look in his wife's mouth. Think about that. Never thought.
Maybe she was just missing some teeth.
Could be. But there's other evidence that Aristotle didn't like to do experiments. Because the Greeks thought they could figure everything out. They were smart. So this is the main point of this talk here. I'll show you a couple of different ways of thinking about it. But if you think about what's the normal way you actually do things, but in fact, what's the normal way you do engineering? This is why engineering is capable of being invented thousands of years before science. Because you don't have to understand a lot to do engineering. You can do it with cookbooking, and that's not a bad way to do it. It's better than tinkering. Write down the things that work and have a few heuristics, like if some structure collapses, double the cross-section of the beams. A lot of dressing. It's very, very similar to cooking. But the problem is you just never get to anything deeper that allows you to really think. So in order to see reality, we have to destroy reality. That's what all microscopes and telescopes, every kind of instrument, this thing is like a telescope. It's helping you see something you can't see. We need those. So what it means, this is why I complain about education everywhere, including college. Education is really not about most of the stuff that you're learning. education is really learning how to see the invisible. And it's the place where the different parts of computing meet up in an interesting way. Because part of computing is about engineering. It is about using past experience. The other part about computing is that it isn't even close to being a reasonable engineering profession yet. And so there has to be something like science. And they have to co-evolve in some way. What's happened the last 25 years or so, particularly in universities, is the science has not happened. But almost all of that engineering, and that has led to some real problems. Okay, there are gazillions of different biases that are built into our nervous system by genetics. Hundreds. These are a few I got off the net. I added a couple more. Like perfect reasoning from wrong premises. This is the problem with being rational. Rationality only works in mathematics where you can pick the premises. Doing any other kind of reasoning and you don't check the premises against the real world, you're in trouble. Leads to things like concentration camps in Germany. You do perfect reasoning, but if the premises are bad, then the conclusions are going to be bad. Here's a big one. Computing loves this one. Abandoning the real problem for something that can be solved. Looking for the keys under the lamppost of where you left them. Giving up something really important for convenience. And the scaling thing, which I think people have been talked to about, but this is one of the biggest problems in the last 30 years, is that Moore's Law did keep ticking along, and we're still trying to deal with it with things that barely worked about a factor of 10,000 or a factor of 100,000 ago. So it just doesn't work. So Francis Bacon wasn't a computer scientist, but he was one of the first scientists, and his way of thinking about science was, well, we've got things terribly wrong with our brains. Part of it is we're born with them. I just showed you one that we're born with. Our cultures are terrible because they're just local myths and rules of thumb. Our languages don't represent the world very well. And academia is terrible because it keeps on teaching old things and is very stubborn about it. So these were his four idols that humans worshipped. And he proposed a solution for it. This is in 1620. And he called it a solution science. So his way of thinking about science is a collection of heuristics for getting around with what's wrong with our brains. Secondarily, it's also good at dealing with the things we can't see about the universe and can't understand directly about the universe. But in all of these cases, it deals with what's wrong with our thinking. And in fact, his point was human beings actually aren't born biologically to think. If you look at traditional cultures and the education there, it's all rote memorization. It's all catechism. Pretty darn catechismic in universities. It's crazy, isn't it? Because one of the things that did get invented, particularly in the last 400 years, is a set of ways for learning how to think about things in ways that get around many of these biases that lead us astray. So there are hundreds of these. If you're interested, they're called human universals. You can find them on the internet. There's a book by Donald Brown, an anthropologist called Human Universals. And anthropologists gathered these by looking at about 3,000 traditional cultures over the last 100 years or so. And what they're interested in were traits that were never absent from any of the cultures. Every culture had to have the trait before it was called universal. So every culture was hunting and gathering. They were interested in their social kinship, culture, language, fantasy, stories, superstition, vendetta and revenge. About 300. And so the idea is there's pretty good start of evidence for claiming these things as being genetic. They're quite independent of every other kind of thing. And another way of looking at it, for computer people, it's easy to say that these are kind of parameters. You can think of these as typed variables. So we have a type variable for language, and when we're born, we start looking for it. It's known that we do this. And we actually have a type variable for speech sounds. The baby is interested in all 100 speech sounds, and a few years later, it's only interested in about 45 that are around it. And after that, it becomes very difficult for it to even hear the speech sounds. So the strategy of nature is, it's really hard to be specific about the outside world and our genes, but what we can do is to make something like a spreadsheet cell. That's another way of thinking about these things. That's looking, when the baby gets born, it's looking for things that are of a kind. Language-like things, speech sounds-like things. We learn our stereoscopic binocular vision after we're born. And in every case, what we learn is high-resolution versions that we have low-res patterns for. So we're born with an interest in two spots side by side, but we don't know what an eye is. We learn what an eye is from seeing eyes. And some horrible experiments were done in the 50s with monkeys where the monkeys never got to see another real monkey. From birth, they were shown monkeys with their eyes down here and mouth up here. So these are surrogate monkeys, but they could nurse. And the babies were brought up for several years, and when the babies were exposed to real monkeys, monkeys that looked just like them, they were frightened to death. Because one of the things that we have, and all species have, is a thing called the other. And the other is a widening circles of things that we think of as us versus them. So this, in the Middle East, there's a proverb, I against my brother and I against our parents against our neighbors against people across town, our town against the neighboring town. So if you want to unite any group that's at odds in a particular city, get the city to play a sport against another city, all of a sudden all these people will be in the same, like, on the same side cheering. Because the other clicks in and the other is further away than I am. Okay, so what's the anthropologist? What does this have to do with computing? So the anthropologists had started off studying human beings because they were interested in differences. So the original theory was that the differences between cultures were biological. This is kind of a racist theory. Most of the 19th century anthropologists were racist in one form or another. But the more they studied people, they found that what they had was categories in common, and what was different was what got filled in after the baby got born. So the fundamental theory of anthropology is you can take a baby born at any place on the planet, take it to any other place on the planet, and it will grow up as a full-fledged member of the community to where it was taken. Okay, so the other thing that's interesting is that even though these are built in, because the details are not built in, the learning curve on these things takes a while. It takes 6 or 7 years for a child to be acculturated, to learn the language, the stories, the customs, and longer. So once they got this idea, they got interested in, oh, look, what about things that are really interesting that are not everywhere? Well, agriculture wasn't everywhere. And yeah, agriculture was an invention. Almost certainly invented by women around 9000 BC. Reading and writing, 5,500 years ago or so. Math, model-based science, this idea of new. Remember, over on this side, you died in the same culture that you were born into. There's almost no change. Not all of them took 300,000 years. But traditional cultures are incredibly stable, partly by the way they include and exclude different ideas. So the idea of new, the idea of progress, that was an invention. It was talked about in the 18th century when the United States was being invented itself. Jefferson and Madison, in their letters, would say to each other, you know, we should have a constitutional convention every 50 years because the world is going to be different 50 years from now. It's completely new thought. It was an 18th century thought. Thank God they didn't do it. If you can imagine the clowns we have in Congress today trying to put the Constitution together. Thought rather than case-based reason. Cooperation rather than competition. Equal rights. One of the hardest ideas for us to learn. And so if we kind of link up some of these things, we've got genes for coping. We don't have any genes for progress. Progress is an idea we have to impress on the world, but we're naturally set up to try and cope, to try and maintain the status quo in various ways. Competition, cooperation, the other versus equal rights. Our nervous system likes differences better than similarities. Similarities are how you make useful generalizations, quick reactions versus slow thinking. There's no traditional culture on earth that doesn't have the idea of vendetta and revenge. We have it ourselves. The legal system is actually intended to prevent feuding and vendetta. So two, I think, worthwhile thinking about here as we move forward, dealing with the difference between the kinds of things we want to do that are really hard and the things that we're wired to do, because we have to keep some of these things in mind and try to detect when we're just easing into them without even realizing it. Okay. Similarly, we love news because it can be told in a couple of minutes. It's categories we know about. New, real new, not what we get on television or the newspaper, because real new is invisible. We have to learn how to see something that's actually different than what we deal with. It can take years. Something that requires calculus to understand is never going to be shown on the evening news, because it takes a while to get into that kind of thinking. Okay. So here's a model from the 19th century that's actually pretty accurate about us. Rain comes down, randomly disturbs some earth. A little channel gets created just completely randomly, but once you get it, it's actually an amplifier. Because it feeds more rain into that particular channel. Eventually you get one of these guys, and 100 million later, years later, which is all it took to do the Grand Canyon, only 100 million years, you get something that is a complete world that if you were born into it, you might not even have a sense of what there is at the top, the little blue patch up there. Anybody ever been down to the bottom of the Grand Canyon? It's like, there's a little blue up there. What is it? But everything else is this predominantly pinkish kind of color. And of course, if you're a fish born into water, you wouldn't know about water. If you've only got one color to look at, you don't have anything. You would not have a name for it. It doesn't exist because it has to be contrasted with something. So you've got a pretty magnificent version of normal and reality, and yet it's just the tiniest part of what's actually there. So I flattened out the canyon here. My thoughts are like a little ant crawling around the canyon. I can do all kinds of things. I can pick different directions. I can, when I encounter an obstacle, I can figure out how to get around it. I can do problem solving. And maybe I'm taking a shower or out for a run, just waking up in the morning, and I have a little blue thought. But I've been to school, I've been to church, I've gone to college. They're flat. Because that blue thought doesn't fit. It's basically noise, as far as the pink is concerned. It makes sense to remove noise. But I might have a really unguarded moment, and all of a sudden, I get a whoops. I got something that is not in this plane at all. I might start off, I might share something on here, but it's just qualitatively different. And what I've suddenly discovered is whatever dimensionality I thought I was in is another dimension. In fact, it's a whole other universe. Could be a bad universe, could be a stupid universe, but it could be a powerful one. And Paul Hindemith, the composer, said, well, this is what happens when you're listening to great music. You're listening to the music, and the next thing that happens is something you anticipated, and the next thing that happens is something you anticipated. You don't feel anxious, but you start getting bored. If the next thing that happens is not at all predictable, and the next thing that happens is not at all predictable, you start getting upset. Just random noise. But, he says, if the next thing that happens is something you didn't predict, but you can then see that it was another possible consequence of where you were, you start getting excited. The hair starts standing. Anybody ever have a hair standing up, stand experience from music? Like, holy shit, that's a technical term, whoops. It's like, and if you think about it now, you can feel a little bit, because you can actually remember, you can get the vestiges of it back. And that's the excitement of leaving one world and going to another. And of course, that's what art is about. Art's purpose is to remind us that there's more than the world that we're in, whatever that world is. And we may have different reactions. So Kessler, Arthur Kessler here, said, well, it could be a joke, because that's what a joke is. Joke, somebody takes you down the garden path in one context and suddenly reveals you in another context. And if it's aggressive enough, you'll start laughing. Could be discovery. Science has this property, right? You didn't think it was going to be there. And you start laughing most of the time. Anybody ever do a discovery? Sometimes kind of humor. It's like a joke that the universe played out, because the stuff was right there the whole time. We have never invented a single new thing for nature. It's always been there. So of course it's funny when we say, oh, it's right there, right in front of my nose. And then art, it is a longer drawn out thing, because now you're getting that connection with the oceanic. It's the special thing about art. And you know what's cool? Way of escaping from what's a problem with computing into what's good about computing is computing is loaded with these three things. And the one that saves us is ultimately this one. This is the one that actually helps us understand whether we're actually making real progress. And of course, there are other, Coleridge, Rime of the Ancient Mariner guy, was a theatrical critic, and he said, people go to bad theater hoping to forget every television today. Mind-rotting, meaningless stories, for the most part. So people go to bad theater hoping to forget, but they go to good theater tingling to remember. And again, art is what takes you into things that you already know, but you've forgotten you. Really important things often. and effect, because it's hard to talk about what aesthetics is all about. What's interesting is to just look at all the different situations where people make noises like this. And so Feynman used this to point out that, hey, science is an art, mathematics is an art, because it has the same kind of aesthetic and transformational properties as all the rest of this. This is a good argument for learning everything in undergrad. This is why you should not concentrate too deeply. Learn everything. You'll have the largest possible chance to see a connection between this and some new world. Because a lot of these connections are kind of analogies, right? Like puns. Okay, so here's a practical one for you guys. See, all you see these graphs all the time. Time going that way, progress. Yay. Could be rating scores. Could be the stock market. What does it mean? Nobody knows. Because nothing counts on a graph like this unless you have at least one threshold. Like if it's reading and this is the threshold for what is actually needed. These are all years. You got past the threshold of fluency. But what if the threshold is like this? And it happens to be for reading. In this case, whether it's an up or down, doesn't matter. This is what's fun. This is the non-linearity of thresholds. This absolutely doesn't matter because there are just a lot of things where you have to get up to a certain plateau before they count at all. And so what you wind up with is something that gives you a qualitative gap between what you're hoping for and it's getting worse. And what is actually needed is getting worse. So there are a lot of things where there are efforts to do something about it. And usually it's all of a sudden we have to work on it now. How about coding for everybody? Grind, 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 fizzle. Because there's no there there. Could be education. Could be the moonshot. When Kennedy announced the moonshot, 61, something like that. You weren't around. I was 21. My first thought was, oh no, there goes space travel. Why? Because there's no way to do a moonshot in less than 10 years without using chemical rocketry, which is the only kind of rocketry that you had to do back then. And was anybody... tell me the formula of what's wrong with chemical rocketry. This is the kind of stuff everybody should. Yes?
The rocket equation?
Pardon?
The rocket equation?
Well, just give me the simplest one.
Well, the fact that the amount of fuel you need is exponential? Or,
yeah, it's just this. That's all there is to it. You have to get rid of something in order for the rocket to move. And a big problem is that you cannot get the mass that you can carry with you to a high enough velocity to get it to move the rocket in any reasonable way. And so we basically had a 40-story building that was a Saturn rocket, and all but the top few feet of it were a high explosive. And almost all of that was just to get up about 50 miles, because it has to carry itself. So everybody who read science fiction in the 50s knew you had to have something like atomic power in order to get enough escape velocity of what you're ejecting in order to carry enough fuel in order to do interplanetary space travel. And so what happened was the moonshot actually set back real space travel by more than 50 years now. This happens over and over again. Most of the education shots set back education because they wind up discouraging people. What they don't realize is they're just not doing it right. And so the failure, they tend to blame the messengers rather than themselves. The web, another one, we can talk about that later, but it set back actual interactive computing by decades. We haven't caught up yet. So, there are two words, better and perfect. These are the enemies of what is actually needed. Better is the one that is most seductive because, hey, I'm making progress. God damn it, look at this. Perfect is for idealists like me. So I have a heuristic that keeps me from trying to be what I'm desiring. And I have some friends who help me with it. But you need to know these things. So what you actually want is to spend an arbitrary amount of time to find that spot. I call it the MacCready sweet spot. MacCready, anybody know who he was? Yes. Oh, come on. Anybody? Come on, listen. I'll give you a hint. He won an interesting award in the last century. He won the Mechanical Engineer of the Century Award. Think about that in the context of the 20th century. Now do you know who he is? Okay, so you're not serious. You're in an engineering school, you don't even know who your Einsteins are? He's the only person to have four of his airframes in the National Air and Space Museum. Now do you know who he is?
Like our prominent rocket systems. I mean, well, that wasn't him though. We had like, the Germans for that.
No, but I'm not talking about. I'm just.
Well, I'm just thinking air. Like if he has an airframe, 20th century, did cool stuff. I think shooting things to the moon. But.
No, it's not that. That's not what he did.
Yes.
He did. No, he did vampire flight. He did the keep a plane aloft forever on solar power. He did make a machine that will fly like the largest flying creature that ever lived. He was actually the invention of the drones. Did a million things. Basically, one of the world's greatest problem solvers. And his primary heuristic was to spend as much time as possible to figure out what that was. And so I'm not taking time, not maybe another time I explain to you how they did manpower. You have to realize people for manpower flight, the best people in the world tried for 45 or more years to do it. And MacCready was able to do it in less than 6 months once he decided to take a shot at it. And then he did the flight across the channel a year later. So it wasn't even a contest. When they had the first solar-powered race in Australia, he won by more than 24 hours. It wasn't anybody remotely close to it. He was one of the main inventors of all electric cars that we had, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But the point is, you should know who these great engineers are. So that's what MacCready did. And so a combination of things, once you get there, and it might take a while, should be willing to spend that while, because you know where you're trying to get. All of a sudden, you've found another blue plane where things are completely different, because you've found what the principles are that are going to make the actual problem easily. People spend too much time trying to solve the actual problems because you're rewarded. Yes?
So question on the graph. When you have the progress bar going down, should what is actually needed just be getting farther away? Or I'm not intuitively understanding like what that means.
You mean where?
Yeah, like the pullback on the progress. Like that where you point.
Oh, it could be. Yes, maybe I should have put in a different graph here. You're reading it more carefully than I intended to.
Oh, okay.
but you should be rewarded for that. And I'm just doing it right now.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
So you're talking about solving the actual problem, but isn't that what is actually needed?
No. No. So just to do the manpower flight one is kind of fun because he never, although he knew something about flying, he was the first American to win the world soaring champion. And he was an aeronautical engineer. He was not interested in, and he knew a lot of people who were doing it. But it happened that his brother-in-law had a business that failed. And MacCready, to make his wife happy, assumed his brother-in-law's debt. And this is $100,000, which is probably around $700,000 or $800,000 today. So it's a big hit for him. And he was driving across the desert with his family, and just musing around. And that morning he had seen that the British pound was $2. And the Kramer Prize for manpowered flight happened to be 50,000 pounds. He was in the middle of the desert and said to himself, boy, if I could do manpowered flight, I could pay off my brother-in-law's debt. So then he started thinking about it. And his first thought was, why haven't all of these good people been able to do this in the last 40 years? And he decided, it's not that the problem is hard, we don't know what the problem is. Because these were not amateurs doing this thing. And so he thought, well, why don't we know what the problem is? And the answer was, well, they fly one of these airframes, they have a crash, and it takes them a year to make another one. Because they're all made as light as possible. And they have all of these things on them. And he said, okay, that's not enough crashes. What we need, forget about manpowered flight, what we need to do is figure out an airframe that we can have 12 crashes a day. So when he got back to his group, said, okay, we forget about, we're going to do manpowered flight, but first, let's come up with something that can survive 12 crashes a day. So it needs to be fixable with scotch tape and wire. And it has to be kind of, it has to have an enormous wing, it has to be light. But it's just, if I showed you the pictures of it, it's laughable. And this thing that they made never won the prize. But in 6 or 8 weeks, they had more flights than all the rest of the people in all the rest of history together. And they finally figured out what the problem was, which is, in part, how to turn something with a wingspan bigger than a 747 that is going only a few miles an hour and has enormous rotation inertia, how to keep it from just dipping the wing into the ground, because you could not get it very high off the ground. And so it was a control system problem, and they were able to do all the experiments there. So like I say, less than 6 months after he had that drive through the desert, bingo. And once they had done that, the bigger prize, which was a 250,000 pound prize, millions of dollars, which is to go across the channel. The first thing was only 1.8 miles in the figure eight course. The next one was 22, 23 miles from England to France. They just knocked it off. And in the interview, one of the British broadcasters asked him, how were you so successful? And he said, well, everybody else was trying to make an airplane. We were trying to do manpowered flight. The first thing he did was abandon the airplane because the scaling was so far off, nothing was known. So the fact that it looked like an airplane didn't mean anything, because every piece of aerodynamics on it was something that they didn't have a model for. So they had to find, it was like, I don't know if you heard the story of Galileo and the gates of Bologna. Well, I'll leave that for another time. Okay, so basically, just putting in, so this is slow thinking here. This is basically going away from what the goal seems to be in order to gather enough knowledge to come up with a good version of the goal. Okay, so here's a little, this is a little true story from my own history. Might find it interesting. So in 68, I was a graduate student, and my thesis project was this machine. This is a self-portrait of it. So it looks kind of modern. Had a pointing device, had an object-oriented language and operating system. Those are the kind of theses we did back then. And I ran into an educator, Seymour Papert, and he was working with children, and I immediately abandoned this desktop machine as a good idea, because children needed something like this. So this is a little sketch I made on the plane from that, back from that trip. Two kids learning physics, two 12-year-olds learning physics by having programmed their own space war game in a child-sized object on the dome with wireless networking, et cetera, et cetera. So, crazy. There weren't even any personal computers back then. But we had something fruitful, which had been announced a few years before, which is Moore's Law. And Moore's Law was partly physics and partly engineering. And so if you just took Gordon Moore's 30-year projection out, you could count the number of transistors, what they would cost, and so forth. And so my thought was, let's take the puck out here into the far future, where we don't have to worry about how we get there, but just to ask. In 1998, it would be ridiculous if we didn't have a flat screen laptop computer at consumer prices, wouldn't it? So this is the question you have to ask. To take the thing so far away that you're not tempted to be engineering about it. Because engineering, you want to work from what you know. Here, what you're asking is, gee whiz, if Moore is right, then I'm going to be able to put all the transistors from my desktop machine on the back of a flat screen display. There are flat screen displays starting to happen, the old ones. And 30 years out, slam dunk. Don't know how to do it, doesn't matter. Because now, you start bringing that thing back. So the first place you bring it back to is about 10 to 15 years out, and you start thinking real thoughts between where you are here and where this is. What is this thing that's a slam dunk out here, what is it likely to be about 10 to 15 years out? That's a bunch of different things, but what you need to do is to simulate it. And the cool thing about Moore's Law is that at least for 20 years in the future, you can have what a consumer will use up to 20 years in the future, and right now, just for money, right? The consumer thing in the future is the supercomputer of today. All I need is a freaking supercomputer. And it's important, because look at what you guys are computing on. You're computing on the computers of the past and the software of the far past. There is no way you're going to get into the future doing this. This is wrong. Why do you even think these things are just conveniences? They have nothing to do with what you should be doing in school. Because you're computing in a place where in order to do anything interesting in the future, you're going to have to do so much optimization on these today that it's going to be beyond what a single student or a couple of students can do. Think about it. This is the equivalent of chemical rocketry. You can compute. You can't do it. And it hasn't been to happen. So this is the funny thing about these commodity devices. They've actually set back computer science research tremendously. Yes?
So What you are saying, if I understand it in the right way, you are saying that actually the problems that we have today compared to 30 years ago are kind of different, but still some of them are not supposed to be solvable as of now. Huh. However, I have a different perspective. Like you said at the very beginning, people are happy with what they currently have. So, I mean, from the consumer standpoint at least. I believe that, and meaning no offense of course, starting 30 years before, up to this point, innovation was easier than it is right now. Because back then, we didn't have anything. Whatever we could come up with, everybody would be happy. And right now, people are glad to have all these devices.
Okay, can you explain to me why the internet was so easy?
No, I'm not saying that.
Oh, I thought you were.
I'm saying
you said
that
it was so easy.
I feel that innovating today.
Didn't you just say?
No. I mean, innovating today, I feel it's more difficult because people are actually happy with what they have.
Yeah, but that's what my talk is about. That's what I said in the beginning.
So
if you're happy,
correct,
you should go somewhere else because you're not going to help computing.
So my question is different. Do you think that innovation is used to be more difficult, or today is more difficult than it used to be 30 years ago?
I think it depends entirely on the context of the people who are trying to do things. This is the best time in which to live to be a computer innovator, because my God, the amount of storage, I won't even bore you with what we had to do to deal with the minuscule amounts of storage in every level of storage. Every part of it required enormous amounts of engineering to do. Now the problem is the resources are abundant, but people are not using them because they can't see what they should be doing. Yeah, it's much easier now. It's interesting that back when it was really difficult to build a computer, almost every major university in the country built their own with the students, and the students did the operating system and the software on it. They did both the hardware and the software. And it was, let me tell you, it was no trivial matter to deal with core memory back then, because just the power supplies, the cabling, it was exponentially more difficult than making a computer today.
Don't you think that people currently, they're kind of, it's harder to convince people to use something?
Well, but that's, let me keep going.
Okay,
so, yeah, so you just pay some money, bring the puck to a couple of years out. And when you've got that, now you can take what little you know from the past, and you can build something that is going to be a commodity 50 years out. So here's the Xerox PARC Aldo, the designer of it, Chuck Thacker. It was roughly, in 1973, it was roughly what a Mac was in 1989. And in today's dollars, it cost about $125,000. We built 2,000 of these. Think about it. Just for a second. Imagine if you could have $125,000 worth of computer. Imagine the experiments you could do without having to optimize. All the user interface, all the real-time experiments. So there's the Alto, and we have another genius to develop the software of the future on it using a few ideas I came up with, Dan Engels. And the result of this was something that Steve Jobs saw 6 years after this machine appeared. In his visit in 1979, the Macintosh appeared in 1984, 11 years after this machine had been done. And so the pitch here is, if you want to get into the future, you have to have a flight simulator. And you can build that flight simulator. That flight simulator will tell you how to build the real thing. Do many experiments without having to optimize. And if you optimize them, you make far future app. For instance, an example is Microsoft Word is originally done at Xerox PARC in 1974. It was a product in 1984. It takes a while to do software. This is the problem. And if you've got the software gated to some sort of cycle out in the business world, you're screwed because you can only do little things. That's what people have been doing, tiny little things. If you want to do something serious, you have to back off and give yourself a much longer development period. Okay, so heuristic is have a glimmer of an idea, take it out, pass the ridiculous test, bring it back with money, and make a flight simulator. This is how you make real progress in computing. Yes?
Isn't it possible that at least some software innovations aren't resource limited, even with current hardware? And it's just like, it's just we need some new step of imagination, but there's nothing stopping us from doing it.
Well, I think there's nothing stopping our imaginations except ourselves. And then the question is if the new thing is actually new, then you're going to have to find out about it. And the question is how difficult is that going to be? Right? And one of the things that's well known is when you take your design hat off and put on your optimization hat, you can't get the design hat back on again because you're in two different worlds. I think people who've done serious software development have had that sense because you're thinking about different trade-offs completely. Okay, so here's an answer to one answer. Remember, you're not supposed to believe me, but. So this is is backed up by evidence, but it's a little difficult to quantify. So take the 5% here as meaning small. So basically, it's a human trait that when something new comes along, about 95% of us evaluate that new thing. It could be a tool or an idea. Evaluate on whether it contributes to their current set of goals. In other words, most humans are goal conservative. That's good because, you know, you have to stick with the goal if you're going to do it. About 5% of us, a small number, get interested in the idea of the tool on its own merits. They're interested in novelty. They start playing around with it. And some of them will abandon their old goals because a new thing came along. So we could take another dimension here, inner directed versus outer directed. It's about 85 and 15. These are not completely independent dimensions, but let's assume that they are for a second. So we get something like this, and about 1% of us are ideas new and inner-directed. So that's an interesting combination to think of. We like new. We're not goal conservative, and we're inner-directed. We don't give a shit what anybody else thinks. And about 80% of us are gold conservative and we're out of direct. We do get a shift. So there's an enormous conflict between these two groups, and I think you can see that the presence of these two accounts for a lot of the dynamics over the last few thousand years. It takes a long time. This group basically does not change because it's a good idea. It changes when everybody feels like changing. So it takes them a long time to work up to something where everybody's used to it. And sometimes it's faster than 30 years, but 30 years is a good time for this. But how long did it take before it was socially acceptable to wear a baseball cap backwards? Outliers started using about 30 years. How long did it take for it be okay for girls to show their belly buttons after the outliers started? About 30 years. Because that's how long it takes to get used to it. There's a generation in there. So if you want to get something happening, you have to do something like starting rumors. Because there's not thinking going on here, but what there is correlation. So it's a completely different. You try to give a pitch to a group like this, you're dead. Because they just don't live in the same universe. Okay, so and we got this. So here's a old typewriter. Now it's fun to look at the keys here. For instance, here's an E, pretty smudged up. The T is almost gone. Sort of randomly down there. And the reason for this is that for some reason the main mechanism for doing a typewriter consists of throwing these keys at the platen up there, and even a typist who's typing really accurately but too quickly will get another one of these guys going up there before the other one has had a chance to come back. And get it. So it turned out that women, especially in the 1880s, were fabulous typists. They loved it. It was great. And so this keyboard was invented to give these women the hardest to type on keyboard that you could possibly type on. That's what the QWERTY keyboard is. Christopher Scholes did that. Now here's my Blickensderfer. I've never seen a Blickensderfer, but here's one. I have it in my house. Notice what it's got up there. This is from 1904. This is the first golf ball typewriter. No, IBM did not invent this. All mechanical, beautiful. And it's worthwhile taking a look at the layout of the keys here. B, T, A, I, M. Those are the most used keys. Why not put them down there? Because this thing can only type one character at a time. There's no possibility of jamming it. And so the Blickensderfers in 1904 had a completely optimized keyboard. Turned out Blickensderfers of 1915 had QWERTY keyboards. And the reason is nobody was willing to change over just because there was a much more efficient way of doing things and the possibility of jamming had been removed. Linotype machines, which are before your time also, had ETAION SHERD-LU as their home row of keys. Those are the most used keys because of the way linotypes set type. So QWERTY we still have with us, and it's worth trying to find QWERTYs. Like, what are the QWERTYs in the programming languages that you program in? Write them down. Try and find it. What are the things that are absolutely stupid and getting in your way? Okay, so I'm going to get past another little metaphor. English is a hard noun language. It's about things more than anything. And so if we treat ideas as matter, they don't interpenetrate. But we could treat ideas as light, in which case we get superposition. That's kind of cool because we don't have to make a choice. And the design t-shirt is something that treats ideas as radiation. Because a lot of what design is about is to postpone making a decision, the exact opposite thing that you're taught to do on a test, which is to make quick decisions. Show them what you know. But in design, what you want to do is to hold things that seem mutually incompatible simultaneously while you're trying to understand what's really going on. Okay? So here's started A, we look out in one direction, We think we're going to go to B, but there's more dimensions than we think. Whoops, that's not a good way to do it. So we have to go away from our goal to get there. And once we do that, we could do a superhighway called Powerful Ideas to get there. And then we can start thinking about eliminating the problem of terrain. And that gets us into one of these blue worlds again. So again, this is kind of a thing. Most problem solving is taught to go at it. This is what I was mentioning before. But it turns out when you get into the real game, and this is part of the problem, the problem of school is small problems. And you solve small problems in a different way than you solve large problems. Good graduate school only has graduate students working on large problems, because that's what the real deal is. And so small problems tend to be algorithmic, large problems tend to be system dependency. And so they're really two completely different worlds. Okay, where are we on time? Is this a...
Well, we still have 25 minutes.
Yeah, why don't we just quit for some questions? Yes.
So going back to the beginning, you said that we need a certain amount of discipline built into us in order to do good design. So as computer science majors that have been sort of introduced to some of the capabilities of what the technology can do, how do we go about building up the discipline so that we can,
the word meta gets thrown around a lot. But you can think of the practical matter, many of the practical matters of engineering are one kind of discipline. It's worthwhile learning it. I was very lucky to go to an engineering high school, so I got a lot of it at a very intense place early on. But it's like the discipline between being in a military engagement and being a good cop. Right? So the military engagement is really complicated because things are less under control. What discipline means there is very different from being a good cop. A good cop is one who won't pull the trigger. And that's a different kind of discipline, and enormously different, because it goes against our own instincts of self-preservation, various kinds. And similarly, in the design thing, or how many people here play baseball? Okay.
So most American males play baseball at some point.
Yeah, have played baseball.
Right.
Thank you, yeah. So basically, there are two kinds of things in baseball. One is not being able to hit the ball successfully at the plate, which you're really good if you only miss 70%. Right, so 70% not being able to hit the ball successfully is fabulous in baseball. And then there's catching a fly ball. And there, you're considered to be making errors every time something goes wrong. And that term is never used when you strike out. It's not an error. Striking out in baseball is an overhead of doing something really difficult. So you can think of the fielding percentages are typically around 98%. So you're doing well if you make less than one error in 50 chances. And you can think of that analogy works pretty well in what we're talking about here. There's a technological, there's a technique part where it's the equivalent of all those scales you have to play in music and stuff. The trick in music is to not translate the mechanical nature of the scales into your playing music. What you're trying to translate in there is the ability of your nerves and muscles and fine muscle memory to react quickly. But you don't want to play music like you're playing scales. They're really two completely different things. And so the thing in computing, I think, is you really have to learn everything. Because, but you absolutely have to put it somewhere so it doesn't affect your thinking about what you're trying to do next. Otherwise, you're just trapping yourself into pure engineering rather than actually dealing with the problem, I think, as it really exists, which is we hardly know how to do anything yet in computing. And so recapitulating old bad ways of doing it just because they're part of the knowledge is a bad idea. But if you can loosen up, well, Michelangelo, I don't know what metaphors you like. Michelangelo was one of the great dual mode artists of all time. So if you think of something that nobody would think of on the Sistine Chapel ceiling. But then the cool thing, the thing people don't realize about Michelangelo, is he spent literally 4 years lying on his back with candle wax dripping onto his face, painting that ceiling. Right? It took him, you know, a month or two to organize what it was going to be and follow his imagination. Then he had 4 years of ball-busting effort to get the damn thing done. And one of the biggest problems is being able to have that kind of discipline, but except when you're having an idea. Right? You don't want to worry about how hard it's going to be to paint the ceiling. You're going to talk yourself out of it. You know, first you get the idea, and if an idea is really good, it supplies a lot of its own motivation for all this back-breaking stuff that you have to do. So it's another way of thinking about it. So it's not a single religion kind of idea. It's a thing where you're compartmentalizing the different aspects of design, the science parts, the engineering parts, and then realizing that most of these are kind of desperate. Alex showed you the world stuff. So probably the worst idea that has held on from the dark past is munging a variable to make a state change. That goes all the way back to the earliest days of first programmable computer ENIAC by Maurice Wilkes. And he said in his a note that he had that he was walking up the stairs in Cambridge and it suddenly occurred to him he was going to spend the rest of his life finding and debugging bugs in his programs. Because the degrees of freedom in the way they were doing it back then multiplied too quickly to make it easy to corral things that could, inadvertent things that could happen that were like sending messages to a wide variety of things. And any kind of variable is global to more than one line of code, it is actually the equivalent of sending a message to a whole bunch of people. Anybody can see that variable can receive that message and they may have no idea why it got in there. So on the other hand, conceptually, the idea of munging a variable is satisfying and easy because it's a parallel with an equality constraint, right? And so an interesting question, and for instance, the language, have you shown them Lucid?
No.
Okay, so Lucid, go look at Lucid by Ashcroft and Lodge. One of a number of attempts to take something like functional programming, but make it conceptually in the space of the much simpler space of thinking about munging things. You know, a variety of those things, and a master mechanism is one that Alex has shown you, which is this worlds mechanism. So if you have thought through how worlds are, in other words, what the time zones are, what the transactional nature, the kind of things that you want to do with databases, you won't find anybody in a company who will bitch at you if you want to do an atomic transaction on a database, right? Will they? No way. Because there are actually legal ramifications if they allow those databases to get corrupted, their banking records or other kinds of things. They need to have atomic transactions. So the problem is the programming languages that this stuff is written in, they don't have atomic transactions. And so the data may be okay out on the disk, but what's happening internally is things getting munched right and left without any recourse to something that is perfectly straightforward now in the database world. However, the idea of atomic transactions and doing them in a practical way were completely controversial back in the late 60s and early 70s. Everybody fought this. And this guy, Jim Gray, who was a student of Butler Lamson, got the Turing Award for was the guy who did the heavy lifting on IBM System R to get it to be a practical thing that could actually predict a wide variety of people trying to do things with large databases. So, okay, another, not too long winded, yes, as long winded. So when I think of the programming language design problem, I think you've got three or four different things that are worthwhile thinking about. First, I've never designed a programming language without 20 driving examples. And you have to think about what those should be. Those are the most critical things, because you don't know what the design is yet. So you have to kind of find your heart. This is this emotional part of the thing. So you have to, this is where you have to be critical. You have to take things that, God damn it, they should just be nicer. Or God damn it, they should be clearer. Or they should be safer. But there's a God damn it in there on every single one of those things. And then you have to have a little example of what it should be like. Worlds is interesting because you know, it's time to revisit worlds, Alex. It really is, because the mechanism is there, but we don't know how to program in it. Right? So we've got this thing that, because if you think of file versioning as the coarsest grained undo that you can have and checkpointing, and you can, worlds allows you to work it down to things that are at least real time for a human. There are different domains there. The complexity of what happens when you do backup, like the nice thing about worlds is it will back you up to a state you were in before, absolutely. But now what would your code do when it's going to follow an alternative? So this is like rethinking the whole notion of what try is, but try without side effects now. Probably something more like possible worlds reasoning in AI than anything that's done in standard programming, right? Because it starts merging its way into things where you can start now writing programs that actually are not, are any particular pathway is not completely guaranteed. But in fact, the state of every single one of them is completely understood. So if you write another program that looks at these programs trying to accomplish much more complicated goals than simple algorithms can. Okay, other, and I came to, yes, sir. Oh, didn't want to upset you. Yes, sir.
So I thought that this was a great talk because it really showed what I've seen before and I haven't been able to really explain it. And I thought I did a good job of sort of explaining these innovations that we've seen throughout our times and before that, and how people actually were able to sort of shoot for the stars. And I guess my question is, have you heard of Blackbird before?
Blackbird? You mean, the only Blackbird I know is the Lockheed Martin.
No, yeah. It's a land-based, so pretty much there was this thing on the internet a couple of years ago where somebody said there's no way to go downwind faster than the wind. And these engineers in a small garage in Silicon Valley said, no, we can definitely go faster than the wind. And so they went out there and they built this device and it blew the minds of aerospace engineers everywhere because nobody had ever thought that you could go faster than the wind. No one had ever proved it. And it was...
Okay,
it was
just, now wait, so let's home in on this.
Oh, sorry, with just wind. Sorry, yeah, with just the power of the wind.
Yeah, so, well, I was a sailor in my youth, and every sailor knows that if you have a decent boat with a decent keel, you can sail faster than the wind.
Yeah. But you can only do that for a certain portion of time. So it was actually inspired based off of that. They created propellers that would enable you. A propeller is essentially like you're always.
Yeah, so I'd like to see that. It sounds like something that Saul Griffith would do, and maybe he did.
It was really cool, and I met the engineers, and it was funny to just see how.
So you know why a sailboat can sail faster than that?
Yeah, it's, you're going perpendicular, you're cutting across, right?
No, it's that when you're sailing into the wind, the sail becomes a wing.
Interesting.
So you get Bernoulli, that's why the really fast sailing yachts have the sails battened to keep them stiff so they'll hold their shape. The keel is there to keep the wind from blowing them sideways. Right, so it's the combination of that plus the keel keeping you from blowing sideways that forces you ahead. And you can sail up to about almost twice the speed of the wind in a good boat.
Yeah. This was land powered. I highly recommend you check it out.
But this does sound like Saul Griffith, who we should actually get here.
That would be awesome.
Oh man, he is something else. If you want to listen to somebody who's invented a few things, he's not quite Paul McCready, because nobody was, but he's right up there in being one of the great mechanical engineers of our time. Really fantastic. So, again, don't believe anything I say, but if you can't find a way, so here's what do marketing people want? Marketing people are interested in finding out what humans want and helping them want. So if you look at consumer marketing, it is very much on the, remember that right-hand column of all the things we're born with? We're interested in stories, now we have technological story amplifiers, we're interested in fantasies, now we have technological fantasies. So if you want to make $1 billion, just take the things that we're genetically interested in and make a technological amplifier for
them. Revenge amplifier.
And that's known as a gun.
Or the missile.
Yeah, so, but what are educators out after? Educators are out after what they think people need. And what people need is very often not what they want. Right? We need to control our impulses, but we want to have impulses. We want revenge, but we need to hold back. So one of the reasons education is so unpopular is because when it's really working well, it is actually training people against most of their genetic material into behaviors that are not like our natural behaviors. This is why writing had to be invented. Why deductive mathematics had to be invented. We aren't born with it. Why science was only invented 400 years ago in its modern form. Democracy, the notion of equal rights, all of these things go against what we're actually born believing in, that pink cloud up there. And so, same thing in computing. The number one thing is to try and understand when you're following your impulses. Are you just doing what you want, or are you doing what the situation needs? And this has been easy in other forms of engineering, because people get put in jail when they build a bridge that crashes. One big one just happened in India that killed, I think, 80 or 90 people. And that just cannot, should not be. And especially now, when there are CAD systems that also do the physical simulations, there should never be a bridge that crashes. If you look at what the CAD people are doing in mechanical, electrical, biological, structural engineering, it's way ahead of what computing does. Most computer people are still typing into black screens on bi-terminal emulations, whereas in mechanical CAD, they're designing systems that the system automatically simulates, and in many cases now can go directly to fab.
We should be able to do that in software today, and we aren't. So just think about where we are. So here's what's the irony. The irony is that every single one of those CAD systems that is so much better used by other fields is done in a computer program. Computer programmers are doing programs for these wonderful systems, and they're being macho, and falsely so, on their own bailiwick. They refuse to do reasonable tools, reasonable programming languages, reasonable environments. So just if you think about the future, a lot of the future in almost every field is a CAD, SIM, FAB cycle. And computing may be one of the last ones to join. Okay, so thanks very much for inviting me.
All right, so, and
write those frigging brain bars. I'm gonna be really pissed off. Seriously, think about it. You just got asked to write a measly half page and without any formal requirements of it, without something, without a grade, could even do it anonymously. Come on.
Wait, Alex makes it public.
Pardon?
Alex makes them public after
you
post.
Well, I told you guys, if you didn't want them to be made public, you could tell me, but really, like, I'm pretty disappointed with those because I would have thought, like, people would have had interesting things to say, like enlightening things to say.
So there are a couple. The thing, this morning I sent Alex an email and said, did I miss the rest of them? Because I said I only seen about half of the number you gave me for people in the class. I mean, you checked.
Yeah. So like revenge is like a super satisfying thing. People like to like have vendettas against people when they don't do things. They maybe like
no.
Right. So that seems like they're getting waddled in.
No, I prefer just saying people, if people are trying to be professionals, I like to point out when they're not being professional. And you aren't. Write the frigging brain bar, seriously.
But I don't think they're missing that, right? They aren't motivated by some same principle you have, right? They're not, it's not like they don't have enough of a fear of being unprofessional. It's more that there's a reason that they don't want to do it that's perhaps not being addressed or something.
I imagine it's more of my idea of art.
No, but you could do it anonymously. We said that in the beginning. That's the whole point. I don't give a shit who wrote them. I want you to write them. That's the whole point of a brain bar. It has nothing to do with who you are as far as Alex and I are concerned. Nothing. It has to do with what it means to be able to just barf it out in a way that somebody else can read. There are no other restrictions. Think about it. There are no restrictions on it. You're not being graded on it. So the people who didn't do this are completely missing why you were asked to do it. And also you're missing why I always write one when I sign them. And I said in mine that I absolutely hated when teachers would give writing assignments out, and they wouldn't write. What they were saying is, this is for you, you know, this is some sort of cod liver oil pill that you have to take. Bullshit. Writing is actually one of the best ways of helping to organize your thoughts, and when you start out, the reason we call it a brain bath is we really want spew, because the number one thing is just doing it at all. So don't misunderstand. It's absolutely unprofessional to not do it. I expect every single one of you to do one. And do it anonymously, for Christ's sakes. I don't care. But I do care if you don't do it. Really don't. Yes, sir.
For the one page you posted on Piazza? Yeah.
Yes. And that's, so unlike the brain bars, I really don't want to make those anonymous ever. Because I want people to be able to give you feedback on your stuff. Everyone in this class, I want everyone to read everyone else's one pagers. And so, yeah, please put those up by Saturday night so that your buddies, which I'll assign tomorrow, can give you feedback and you can iterate by Tuesday. So, and if you have any questions, please post them on the Piazza and I'll address them as I see them. Yes.
So the deadline is Saturday night.
I said Friday before and people seem to be worried, so I'm willing to make it Saturday night. The sooner the better, I think, because remember, this is just your first draft, and the point is to get feedback from your buddy. So just try to get it out soon. Okay. And seriously, like, if there's anybody here thinking that they're not interested in doing these one pagers, you should drop the class now while you can. Because if you don't, we're gonna have a problem. You got it. Well, you got it. You gotta do it.